Hi, I'm John Doyle and I'm the Artistic Director of Classic Stage, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to Classic Conversations. Now, if you're a regular, you'll know the rules already, but if you're not and you're with us for the first time, I'll give you some background. Now, for some time now at Classic Stage, we've been holding, when we were actually in the theatre, been holding a series of conversations between myself and an artist who was associated with me or with our work, perhaps people who were in the show we were doing or somebody who had been in something in the past. And when we had to unfortunately pause in rehearsal for Assassins, we decided that we would try to continue these conversations in a virtual way with members of that company, really partly so that we could stay in touch with each other and very much so that we could stay in touch with you. The conversation loosely follows a British radio program that I loved ever since I was a boy. So it tells you it's an old program, and it's much loved, and it's called Desert Island Discs. And in Desert Island Discs, what happens is that the castaway has a conversation with the interviewer, and during it, the castaway chooses the pieces of music that they might consider taking to their desert island. When we do these in the theatre, the castaway sings a number of songs, but in this shortened online version, our castaway only chooses two songs, usually, or maybe a piece of poetry, but in the case of today, two songs. Now, if you enjoy our chat, I'd love you to spread the word if you could. If you like us, you know, you could like us on Facebook, you could subscribe to us on YouTube, or simply tell as many people as possible in whatever means you can about this conversation and about the fact that we are going to be bringing Assassins back as soon as we're able to be back in our theatre on 13th Street. So it is with enormous pleasure, because he's a really great friend of mine, to introduce you to our castaway, Eddie Cooper. Eddie, I am so happy to see you. How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm good. It feels like forever since we were in that rehearsal room, doesn't it?
It's weird because it feels like forever, and it also feels like yesterday at the same time.
I know. It's strange because it's like a time warp. How are you coping?
You know, I think I'm doing okay. It ebbs and flows, peaks and valleys. A weird thing, but you know, it's oddly comforting to know that the entire world is going through this at the same time. It's horrifying but also comforting to know that we're all in this together.
That's right, and that we have no sense of control over it all, and we've just got to go with it and live day by day, and there's no choice other than those cliches, is there really? That's what we can do. Now you live in 42nd Street.
I live in Manhattan Plaza,
right there beside Broadway. And were you raised in that building?
I was, yeah.
So you've lived there as long as you can remember?
My God.
I mean, you're the closest I know, really, to a true Broadway baby. I mean, in that you must have been, like, when your dad, Chuck, was on, you know, on Broadway, which he's made many times and continues to be, you must have been a baby even then. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, he had to leave rehearsal for a show he was doing because I was being born.
No.
Yeah.
No. So the Broadway world is what you've known all your life.
Yeah, very much so.
And how do you feel about that?
Well, you know, I understand that it's kind of weird that this is how I grew up, and I was just, this is my world that I've just known my whole life, but to me it's normal.
Sure. And even the sort of, which I'm sure you must, you know, your dad's very successful, but I'm sure you saw him go through the same insecurities and rejections that we all deal with all the time. That must have trained you in a way for what you were going to go into.
I mean, he wasn't always very successful.
No, that's right.
I got to see the whole journey. I knew what I was getting into.
Yeah, and you went to LaGuardia High School for the arts?
I did.
And so how, and did, was that good?
I loved it.
I don't think I've ever asked you about that. We've talked about so many things. I don't think I've ever asked you
what's yeah.
like. I mean,
yeah, it was a great experience, a very unique high school experience, because, you know, I would talk to my, when I went to college, I would talk to people about their high school experiences, and I would tell them my general day-to-day high school schedule, and they would all be like, what?
Amazing. And where did you go to college?
I went to Ithaca College.
Okay.
Where it's very cool.
Cold, yes.
Yeah. But a great place. I also had an incredible time there. Some of my closest friends today are from Ithaca.
Wonderful. How wonderful. And then after Ithaca, you just came back and started working in New York City?
Well, I just came back.
Came back.
I didn't start working for years after I graduated. It was really? It was tough going for me for a while, yeah.
Why? That surprises me.
I was told, and I guess it's true, that I kind of would have to grow into my type.
Yeah. Yeah.
People told me, you know, you're talented, da, 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 but we can't do anything with you for a while because you don't fit in to what we have here. So I just had to wait, and I waited. And
sure. And it happened. Isn't that thing of type, though? It's a terrible thing, isn't it?
It's a very terrible thing. It's silly. I love you because I don't believe you really believe.
No, I don't think about it.
Types.
No. No. I mean, all of us fall in love. All of us feel awful some days, good the other day. Some days we can all be beautiful, some terrible. You know, I mean, we're all the theater is what makes us the same. And it reflects our sameness in some way, I think. And so, yeah, it's so sad that the theater has got stuck in that. And, you know, I don't think it was always quite like that. I mean,
I don't think so.
I don't, you know, I think of somebody like, look, okay, she's an extraordinary talent, but I think of somebody like Judi Dench. Uh-huh. And you couldn't put Judi Dench into a type, right? You couldn't. And yet she's
played, is Judi Dench.
She's Judi Dench, and yet she's played Juliet, and she's played Lady M, and she's played, you know, Cleopatra.
What can't she do?
What can't she do? And that, I think what's happened is that, in a way, the movie industry, which is, I suppose, very linked to type, has had an influence on some casting choices. And but I know that even when I started, you know, there was certainly, you were either a leading man type or a juvenile type or a character actor. And I think what happened often, I'm thinking back to some of my contemporaries who were like you were told at school, well, you won't work until you're 40, you know. Mm-hmm. What a terrible thing to say to somebody. I mean, how do you know?
Yeah, it was a very, very, very hard thing to hear. And a hard thing to come to accept, because you know, I wasn't working and I wasn't booking anything. I actually, you know, I graduated college. I was auditioning and stuff. No traction. Nothing was really happening. And I moved to Japan for a year.
Did you?
I did. I went and taught English in Japan for a whole year. Because I was like,
why not?
I'm not doing anything.
Nothing to lose.
Yeah.
Listen, I'd like us to talk a little bit, and we'll split this up probably, but I'd like us to talk a little bit about our work that we've done together at Classic Stage, because that would be...
I would love that very much.
Nice to do. And my first observation about you is you're always... And I love this. You're always early for everything, right? Every rehearsal, you're there. You and I are always there an hour before, right? You're eating your breakfast and I'm thinking about what I'm going to do that day. I've seen us do it so many times. You, me, and our stage manager, Bernita, all sitting there, you know? And so where did that come from, that sense of needing to be early?
So lots of people who know me and are watching this are going to laugh when they hear you say that.
Really?
Well, yeah, because it's very specific to rehearsals and to my professional life, being early. Yeah,
I see. And just
other things, I'm generally not super.
And just to do with like the need to prepare, is that what it is?
I think, you know, growing up, hearing things from my father, hearing this, I developed a kind of a work ethic to where that is a big part of it to me.
Yeah.
Showing up, being ready. I like to take in the space. Like to, especially when we're at a place like Classic Stage, showing up early there and just walking the space, it is invaluable to me. It really helps me be present and.
Yeah. And it's such a wonderful space, isn't it? Just to be in that room.
It's my favorite.
I know, mine too. So before your first song, talk to me a little bit about our first show that we did together, The Resistible Rise of Arturo Uy. Now, that's a title that would put people off going to the theatre, isn't it, really? what did you make of it? What did you think? I mean, I'm sure you enjoyed it and all of that, but, you know, the making of that kind of work, what did you feel about that?
So that play will always be very, very important to me because, you know, I went to school, I was an acting major in school, and I've never studied music.
Ah.
So I always pictured myself as, you know, when I was younger and when you look forward at what you want to do, I wanted to be an actor. I wanted to do plays.
Sure.
Film and TV, maybe. I wasn't very interested in doing musicals.
True.
And when I finally did start working, I started doing musicals, which is great. And I love.
You have a wonderful voice, so it's understandable. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But my first love really is for doing plays. I did them in college, and that's what I... So that was the first play that I've done since college.
No, I didn't realize that.
Yeah.
Not that it would have bothered me, because I don't really think in terms of musical theater performers or act. You're all actors to me, and you can't be good in a musical unless you're a good actor. You just happen to have a good voice, so that's a nice extra appendage to the whole thing. But mm-hmm. It's the same skill, isn't it? It's the same searching for character, and exploration is the same. So, but of all plays, I mean, complex.
Yeah.
Tell everybody a memory about that one before we go on to a song.
It was an incredible challenge. The text is it's dense, and you have to look at it from a certain angle to really get in there and understand what's happening in the piece.
Yes.
Where you're coming from within the piece. And
you are in the piece, yeah.
It was such a welcomed challenge. I think one of the scarier and exciting moments of the rehearsal process was we were working on stuff, and I ended up at the top. Uh-huh. And you said, "Hey, Eddie, why don't you try out your monologue?" And we had never touched it before.
Nope.
And which is one thing I love about working with you is you're
do it.
Let's just do it.
Yes.
It's only a play. But that was my first time working with you, so I was a little like, what?
I know.
And there were people who I was working with in that show who, you know, I've been fans of for a while.
Sure.
So it was a little like, okay, here we go.
But you
and
did.
You said I did a good job afterwards, and it made me very happy.
That's good. So listen, you're allowed to take, or you're allowed to consider two songs for your desert island. Which is the first song that we're going to hear?
The first song we're going to hear is a song by Ray Charles called Hallelujah, I Love Her So.
Love
and me. It's just a song that there's no way for it to not put a smile on my face.
Beautiful.
And it's just that simple as to why I love the song.
Nothing wrong with that. Here it is.
Yeah.
Let me tell you about a girl I know. She is my baby and she lives next door. morning before the sun comes up. She'll bring me coffee in my favorite cup. That's why I know, yes I know, hallelujah, I just love her so. When I'm in trouble and I have no friends, I know she'll go with me until the end. Everybody asks me how I know, I smile at them and say she told me so. That's why I know, yes I know, hallelujah, I just love her so. Now if I call her on the telephone and tell her that I'm all alone, by the time I count from one to four, I hear on my door. In the evening when the sun goes down, when there ain't nobody else around, she kisses me and holds me tight and tells me, Eddie, everything's all right. That's why I know, yes, I know, hallelujah, I just love her so. Yeah, hallelujah, I just love her so. Oh, hallelujah, I just love her so.
So we did Arturo Uy. I think, you know, you're one of the, you and George Abu, I think, are the two actors in New York who I've done most projects with. I think you are.
That means the world to me.
Oh, and so
also, George Wood is like one of my dearest people now.
Oh, he's so adorable, that guy. And so talented.
Oh, beyond.
Yeah. Now, we then did this strange, rather extraordinary play with songs, we'll call it, musical. I mean, it was sung through, of course, The Cradle Will Rock at CSC, and there was a connection, of course, for me between that and Arturo Uy, in that they were both political pieces of theatre. You know, obviously, Cradle Will Rock, for anybody who doesn't know it, is a piece from that Blitzstein wrote, which explores the political state of the world in America at the time that he was writing it. And I think it's fair to say that probably most of the performers in the piece went into the rehearsal room not really knowing the piece. Is that true? Did you know it?
Yeah, I mean, I knew of it.
Yeah.
I knew of it, but past that, I had never heard any of the music. I had never read it before,
yeah,
you know, getting cast in it.
Yeah. And we, you know, we did it in a very particular way. It was interesting to me because those people who may have been expecting more of a sort of musical didn't quite get that, right? It's more thoughtful than that in some ways, and certainly darker than that in some ways.
Yes.
What were your responses to it, to the piece?
It was such an interesting piece to be doing. I think especially when we did it.
Yeah.
To do that in Trump's America,
yeah,
was poignant, I believe.
That's right.
But it's another piece that I absolutely fell in love with. You know, it's a strange piece. I wouldn't know how to really, prepare people for coming to see it.
I know. That was a real challenge of doing it, actually. I mean, it's one of my absolutely favorite things that we've done there. And I felt very strongly about how it worked and that wonderful company that we worked with. Extraordinary people. And yet, I think you're right. Like, how do you tell an audience what that is? You know, that was a challenge in this day and age in particular. Ironically, I think that play, that piece, is at the time we're in right now, is even more relevant than it was then.
Yeah.
The idea that, you know,
deeply upsetting.
It's deeply upsetting that most of the people, not all, but many of the characters in that play, that musical, wouldn't have been able, you know, would have found it, they were living paycheck to paycheck. They wouldn't have found it easy to put food on the table. And there are a couple of people in the story who did find it easy to put food on the table and who were taking advantage of those who were living from paycheck to paycheck. And it's so interestingly relevant, really.
It just makes you think, like, where have we come?
Yeah.
Because lots of things that need to change and have needed to change 4 years are exactly the same.
How do you find that? And I can talk to you about this, or I would talk to you about this anyway, but I, as a friend, I feel it not difficult to talk to you about this. How do you feel those themes in the theater, as a person of color, how do you feel about the world of the theater now as a person of color? That's a big question.
It's a big question, yeah. I think as a person of color, it's always hard because we're very underrepresented.
Yeah.
It feels like things are changing for the better. Yeah.
Thank God.
Now, but we still have a lot of work to do when it comes to that.
That's right. And good.
I was going to say, I believe that there's room for everyone.
We in
the theater, and if some of the gatekeepers would realize that, and I think it would make the theater a better place. I think it would make the theater a place where more people would be interested to visit.
Yeah.
I hope people start to realize that soon.
I hope so too. I think it is changing. You're right. I think it's a gradual change, and I think they're all good changes. It's funny, as we're talking, I'm struck by when I auditioned you for Arturo Uy, and we sat in that tiny room at the Telsey office, at casting office, and I asked you, I said, look, I'm thinking of you for a particular role, but he's a thug. How do you, as a person of color, feel about that, right? Mm-hmm. Did you think I'd gone mad? You didn't know me. Did you think I was mad asking you that question?
No, quite the opposite, actually. It made me kind of desperate to work with you because lots of people don't think like that and don't, you know, they just... I've been asked really ridiculous things in audition rooms and asked to... They'll use coded language and to try and get you to act more... black or whatever.
Yeah.
I think, you know, it's good to be just out with things. You were thinking of me to play this role who was a gangster. Yes. You understand that as a black man, I might not be interested in perpetuating that stereotype or whatever. I did not feel that the piece did that at all. I mean, it was written for a black dude. It's not like it was.
No.
That cast was a rainbow.
Completely. It was a most extraordinarily wonderful rainbow. And that to me is the most important. I think that's one of the wonderful things about doing classical work, though, that it certainly opens the door to all to be in it, right? You can't say, oh, we're doing King Lear, so therefore everybody has to be white. I mean, nobody cares. And a black girl and a white girl can be sisters, thank God, right? And that should be how we view everything. I'm not meaning to sort of sanitize it all, because we have to take each other's stories into play and be aware all the time of the imagery that we are giving the audience, which could perpetuate without even meaning to. I think it always has to be deeply considered, you know. I'm always very pleased that I've lived long enough to the questions that I'm asking you, the conversation we're having now, when I started in the theater, would not and could not have happened, do you know?
Yeah.
And that's marvelous that we've at least got to the point of, well, we can share now in such a different way, and that's great, you know. And I'm talking to you, I'm thinking about when I directed The Color Purple on Broadway. You know, I was so embarrassed as a white man directing that musical. I thought, this is terrible. I shouldn't be doing this. I was so grateful that I did it because I was truly the minority in the room, and I learned so much from being that. You know, it made me look at the world in a different way. And I think that's one of the great things about theater and classical theater. It can make you look at the world in a different way. So what's your next song?
My next song is a song that my father used to sing to me as a lullaby.
Oh.
My mother is also a fantastic singer, and right. my, you know, they used to switch off singing lullabies to me at night. I had the best bedtime. I mean, like, it was a concert every night. It was wonderful.
I wouldn't mind having Chuck Cooper singing me to sleep. That would be fine.
I suggest it. It doesn't suck.
What's the song?
The song is Blackbird by the Beatles.
By the Beatles.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life, you were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see. All your life, you were only waiting for this moment to be free. Blackbird, fly. Blackbird, fly into the light of the dark black night. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life, you were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise.
The lyrics of that song, they're very beautiful, aren't they?
Yeah.
The broken wing. I mean, it's really a... They were
real... some haunting imagery in it.
Oh, yes. I mean, they were real poets, those guys. I mean, they really, really were. They could... The way they can get right into a sort of microcosm of an idea and yet make it the most beautiful piece of poetic song is... That's why they lasted, I suppose, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I don't... 200 years from now, people are still going to be listening to the Beatles, I think.
Oh my God, yes. I was in a restaurant one night in London, and I've met a lot of famous people in my career, right?
Mm-hmm.
In my life. And I don't usually get starstruck. I don't really care. I don't think about those things. I was in this restaurant, and there at the next table was Paul McCartney with his late wife, Linda. Well, I couldn't eat. I mean, I was just completely, I kept thinking, John, stop staring. Could I stop? No way. It's Paul McCartney.
That's a lot.
So listen, this whole thing is about, you know, we're all in our desert islands right now. You're in yours in Manhattan.
Are you going to ask me the scary questions now?
Yes. you're in your little island. I'm in mine up here in Connecticut. But so if you were only allowed to take one of those two songs to your desert island, which one would it be?
It would probably have to be Blackbird, because that song is like a warm blanket to me.
Yeah. Now, if I was to allow you one song from the musical theater, what would it be? I know that's hard. It's not a question I've asked anybody else.
How dare you?
I know. Did me.
Oh, how dare you?
Just off the top of your head.
It would be... Probably something from Into the Woods. Into the Woods was the first musical I ever saw on Broadway.
Wow.
Which is, like, awesome.
Yeah.
Maybe No One Is Alone.
Yeah. Yeah, I can understand that.
It's a real Sophie's choice, John.
I know. Actually, I'm going to ask you to tell everybody something that you've told me, but isn't one of our questions. But you referred once to see, you told me the story of going to see my production of Sweeney Todd.
Yes.
Tell everybody about that.
Oh my gosh.
Didn't you sit in the front row?
I did.
So, okay. I forget like exactly what I was doing, but a very close friend's mother called me because she knew I was into theater, and she had a ticket to go see Sweeney Todd, which I was already obviously just dying to see because it's my favorite musical, and yeah. Patty, yeah. who you know I'm a little obsessed with. So I was like, yes, I want the ticket. So I get the ticket. I go to the theater, get the ticket. I am dressed in like a shirt that I would not ever wear to the theater. It's this t-shirt with like yellow lettering going across my chest. And like, it's, you know, I'm not talking I wear a three-piece suit to the theater. Just a little bit.
Take an effort. Yeah.
But I had no time. And this is what I was wearing. And this, I was at the theater. And I look at the ticket, and it's in the front row. And I'm like, So I sit there in the front row and just for the whole time, it was beautiful. It was amazing. But Patty comes out at the beginning of Act Two.
Yeah.
And they do, you know, God, That's Good.
We'll help guys.
Mm-hmm. She comes out with her tuba, mm-hmm. and she does the whole thing at me. And she's pointing at me and blowing me kisses, and I mean, like, my head almost exploded.
You had an affair with Patti LuPone there.
Oh. Oh. Done. I tell you, I had, like, a gay aneurysm. I was like,
that is adorable. She probably chose you.
My life.
She probably chose you during Act One. Now listen, you're allowed a luxury to your desert island. What would it be?
Like any kind of luxury that
any luxury, anything.
Oh, a real good bed.
Oh, nice. Yeah, that makes complete sense.
Right? Because I'm thinking we're going to be making
like
a palm bed or something.
Yeah, no, you want
a good bed. I can make a tent.
Yeah, sure. A proper bed.
Give me a nice mattress.
Proper bed. And you'll have one. And what about, you're allowed, two books are already, you're given to take with you, the Bible or any other equivalent religious book. You can have that anyway. You can have the complete works of Shakespeare.
Mm-hmm.
One more book. What would it be?
Oh, that's easy.
Oh.
Lord of the Rings. But can I get all three of them?
Yes, you can have them all.
Yeah.
Do you want to ask me anything?
Lord of the Rings, I'm good.
That's good. Do you want to ask me anything? I've asked you lots of questions.
Yes, I do. And it's something very silly, but I'm obsessed with the door behind you. In my mind, it's a portal to Narnia.
Oh. No, it's just a cupboard, actually. You're just near our front door.
So was the portal to Narnia.
Maybe it is. I hadn't thought of it like that, really. This house that Robert and I live in here is full of doors like that. And when we came here, they were all brown wood and rather, the whole house was rather dark. So we just painted it all white. I kind of love them. And I also love these doors because they're very, to me, they feel very New England, these doors. Mm. We would never have doors like that in the UK. Don't ask me why, but we wouldn't. So I kind of like them. You have to come up and visit us here sometime. That would be good.
You know I want to.
We'll do it. Once all this is over, we'll do it. And just finally, Assassins. I know you've done Assassins once before. You did it at City Centre, and there we were, two and a little bit weeks, nearly 3 weeks into what we were doing, and eventually we'll all be back in the room and we'll do it again. But what stands out to you about Assassins as a piece or as what we were doing? Anything you like.
Well, as a piece, it's one of those pieces that I love a show that, or a movie, or you know, any piece of art that gets better the more you revisit it.
Yes.
And I think Assassins, if there's a if there's any piece that does that, it's Assassins.
Yes.
It just, it keeps on coming. The more you listen to it, the more it's there's so much in there.
Yeah. And it truly is. It's so
brilliant in that way.
Yeah. It's truly a piece of art. You said the right phrase. It truly, truly is. Well, I look forward to seeing you for real in that rehearsal room when the time comes.
I can't wait. I love you.
I love you. I love you dearly. We could speak all afternoon, but take good care. Send my love to the family.
Yes, I will.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thank you for being with us. Our future at Classic Stage is dependent on generosity. We're not able to open our box office at the moment, so it's all about the kindness of our friends and even the kindness of strangers, as Tennessee Williams said. So many people have recently helped us, both in terms of support financially and in terms of their kindness and their commitment to us. If you can help us in any way to keep planning toward our new season as and when the time comes, please visit our website, classicstage.org. Thank you.